Good morning. Can y'all hear me okay? My name is Pamela Lyle. I have the honor of serving as regent for the James Stewart Chapter, National Society Daughters of the American Revolution. Our chapter is pleased to welcome each of you here this morning for, you know, a very special program. I would like to please ask Pastor Grady Woodruff to come up and do our opening prayer.
Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for our presence here today. We pray a special for all of us. We thank you most of all, God, for being who you are. And we are your people. We pray, God, that you bless us here today. And what we have it here with songs, Mr. Troy Good Paul, Mr. Mary Johnson, Hines Johnson. For the legacy here has been in this kind of God, we thank you for her. We thank for all the people that are here today, Lord. Bless them, Lord. We pray, God, your blessing upon them. Don't have travel just to get here, to make this day what it is. Lord, we love you. We still depend on you, and we still need you. We pray, God, that you continue to bless the family of Sister Mary and Johnson, Lord. Bless them, Lord. It's not a minute anymore, for, Lord, but there's still some to fear. We pray, God, that you continue to carry on and doing the things that please in your sight, Lord. If we pray, God, that you would just move self out the way and let you come in and just be in the van in our lives and take control. And bless this program, Lord. Those that are responsible for the effort that they've done, and we say appreciate it, Lord. We give you all the praise for it, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Woodruff. Please rise, if you're able, for the pledge to the flag of the United States of America, led this morning by Amy Cowett, chapter officer.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Amy. I want to recognize some of the people that are here this morning that are guests. Over here on the end, we have City Councilman for Franklin, Charles Israel. Rodney Kay is the superintendent for Hurt County Schools. You've already met Pastor and Mrs. Grady Woodruff. We'd like to thank Dinah Rowe, the Hurt County Extension Coordinator, for allowing us to have this meeting in this building here. And her three 4-H volunteers in the back, Ava, Wade, Ryan, and Megan. And I understand that Megan is an officer in the 4-H here. And Ava, if you notice, has on a very lovely medal this morning. Earlier this year, Ava was honored with the DAR Youth Citizenship Award for an outstanding conservation project here on Franklin Parkway in Hurt County. Thank you all for being here. Also like to welcome Paige Herrick, representing the chapter, but also is the current president of the Hurt County Historical Society, and friends of Mary Johnson and family that are here with us. We want to thank you for being a part of the program this morning. I'd like y'all to welcome Charles Israel, City Councilman for Franklin, Georgia, with a very special presentation this morning. Mr. Israel.
Good morning. Good morning. It is my honor and privilege as a son of an educator and a brother a librarian here in town, but also educated, to be involved here and be able to represent the city of Franklin and the mayor in this. I'll read the proclamation at this point. Whereas Mary Hines Johnson was born March 23rd, 1895, Lieutenant Glenn, Heard County, Georgia. And whereas Mary Hines Johnson, at the age of 14, went away to boarding school in Atlanta, and upon coming home was assigned as supply teacher during the summer term for a vacancy at the state line school for which she previously attended. And whereas Mary Hines Johnson recalled looking into a sea of eager faces and summoned all the ambition of her mother and father before her. That September, she went back to school, and at the end of the school year, and returned to teaching of one teacher's school in an isolated community. And whereas Mary Hines Johnson taught at Ebenezer Church in 1909, but while the church was spacious, she would lay awake at night thinking of the children braving the weather and traveling from all over the county. She knew that something must be done, and whereas through prayer and contributions, Mary Hines Johnson opened a one-room schoolhouse to educate African-American students, gladly giving her $28 monthly salary for the building, followed by the building of a larger school in 1954. And whereas Mary Hines Johnson had a profound impact in the early days of the Heard County school system, and her legacy lives on through her family, neighbors, and her students. Now, therefore, Kevin Hayes, Mayor of Franklin, Georgia, does hereby proclaim October 9, 2021 as Mary Hines Johnson Day in the city of Franklin, and invite all citizens to gratefully acknowledge and recognize her outstanding contribution to the education of African American children and her impact on the educators in Heard County. In witness hereof, we have hereunto set our hand and cause the seal of the city of Franklin, Georgia to be affixed this ninth day of October in the year of our Lord, 2021.
Proclamation, and feel free to come up and look at it, and we're going to find a special home for it here in Heard County so that everybody will remember that this was a day proclaimed for her. Rodney Kay is the superintendent of Heard County Schools, and he's going to bring greetings from the school system this morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It truly is a blessing, number one, to live and work in Heard County. First and foremost, it's the most wonderful place I've ever had the privilege of being. To serve the children of this community is quite humbling. To have a community that rallies like we do to support our kids, and learning more and more about this fine lady, I understand where the beginnings of it were. She humbly served. When I think about giving your salary, it's a true calling. And just selflessly serving. I found out she was a Christian lady, and those values live on in our school system today. Our core values are from 1 Corinthians 13:4, where we said, love is patient, love is kind. I bow to you to continue those things. We continue to try to serve the children just as she did, selflessly. Everything for the children. The motto is putting kids first. And any chance we get to honor an educator such as this one, I'm just humbled and honored to be here. So I greet you this morning from the school system, the 2,100 students, the 300 faculty members that we have, and of course our Board of Education. So thank you for being here this morning.
Thank you, Mr. Kay. Her family members and other people that knew her, as well as her students, were directly affected by her teachings and can best tell her story. Brady Ellis is a board member of the Mary Hines Johnson Foundation and is with us this morning to share some brief words on her impact on himself and the community. Brady?
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Such an honor and a privilege to be here today. I'm not a public speaker by the way, so I'm very shy and nervous up here. but I'm excited because we're honoring the one and only Mary Hines Johnson. And I began school at her elementary in the year of 1988 at 3 years old because I did not speak. My first classroom would have been home ed when it was Mary Johnson High. And I'm going to look through here because, like I said, I'm not a speaker. But Mary Johnson, my first influence on Mary, because I did not know who Mary Johnson was until around February 20th of 1993. I walked one day into the media center, and there was a sign above the library that said Mary Hines Johnson Media Center. And then when I walked into the library, there was a portrait hanging over the library office where the librarian would be. And I would look at this portrait and I wondered, who is this lady? Being, I was 7 years old back then, so I thought maybe 19th century, you know, my dad watched Westerns and stuff, so I thought it was way back in those days. But being 7 years old, you got a vivid imagination. Nonetheless, let me go on down to it. When I went to school at her elementary, you could feel the history in that brick schoolhouse. When I was a kid there, you were treated like family. The teachers there were loving and took care of each and every student as if their own. I can tell you right now that influence came directly from Mary Hines Johnson. And when we get down to Mary Hines Johnson, as Rodney Kay said earlier, she has played a pivotal role in our school system. And it might have been called her elementary when it was that brick school, but it was always the Mary Johnson School. The teachers that was there when I was there, from Marion Roush, Robert Kennedy, Faye Thompson, and so many, these folks were mentors to other teachers. And Mary's influence beautifully integrated among everybody. And these teachers carried the same playbook that Mary Johnson carried. And Mary would also influence. Mary, let me just say this. Mary Johnson was somebody that each teacher should strive to be. She did not let her students give up. She pushed and she made things happen. If we think about it seriously, we need more people like Mary Johnson in this world. A great example I can use of Mary Johnson is there was a young lady that went to her school. Her name was Willie. Sister Willie Woodruff. And she had a call, just as Mary did, to be a teacher. And I've always felt that being a teacher is like when you're called to spread the message of God. It's a special gift. Well, she was nervous. She wasn't going to be able to do it. But Mary Johnson and Mr. Chief Robert Kennedy did not let that dream die. And Miss Willie Woodruff became a teacher at her elementary in the year of 1969, teaching second grade, and would remain for 40 years. Throughout the years that her elementary was the brick school, from 1954 to 2004, there was always a teacher in that school who was a part of Mary Johnson School. If you knew the names of even Theresa Freeman, Mildred Wood, Miss Grace Davis, you had that influence that Mary Johnson upon you. And like a flower, it blooms. It just bloomed. And that influence carried on. And I can see it today as I look in this 4-H building and see all the progress that's been made. That was because Mary taught us, and it carried on to my generation, to have dedication, determination, discipline, and that is something that everybody that came through that school system carries with them to this very day. And if you start something, you finish it. And Mary was truly called by God. And the most inspiring story that I can remember on Mary Johnson was the story about the kids and the bridge. It came a big rain one day, and they got huddled up under the bridge because they were getting rained on, so they got up under the bridge. And Mary said a prayer that day to get have that schoolhouse built, and it was built, the Brown Schoolhouse, as it was called, off Highway 34. It ended up opening. And after that, her legacy began to grow. In 1950 would have been the year that her name became known as the Mary Johnson School on the Ebenezer School on 34. And I can tell you right now that Mary sat there taking a bath, and the one thing she thought in her head was, the job's not complete. There's still work to do. Her dream came true when the brick school was built. And I know that she would have been proud over the years to have saw that brick school grow, to get a gym and the additions added on to it, and the character of that school and the teachers in that school. And she inspired so many people. And that inspiration, I want you to know, still continues in the school today. And we have examples here like Miss Willene Spearman. Miss Willene Spearman started after I started. And when she started, she saw something that was needed. We did not have a Special Olympics chapter in her county at that time. Miss Spearman made that happen. I'm pretty sure she was inspired somewhat by Mary Hines Johnson. And today, at Hurt Elementary, if you're in fourth grade, there's a teacher by the name of Deborah Slate. And Deborah Slate was assistant to Marion Rausch, who was also a teacher at the Mary Johnson School. And that mentorship, I'm sure, carried into Miss Slate. And that influence continues today at Hurt Elementary through her, and Lisa Pless, Carol Barnum, so many, and so on and so forth. Her legacy will live forever. And that's the thing, we want to keep it living forever. And I just want to say, I'm really honored to stand here today and speak on behalf of Mary. Like I said, I'm not a big public speaker. But I want to make sure each word I say is precise. And she truly enriched each and every one of our lives for the better. And my dream is that one day she has a park named in her honor here in Franklin. But I just want to say this. We were richly blessed to have her influence in her county. And it carries on. And always remember, prayer and hard work will lead you to success. And another thing too, I'm gonna leave, this is gonna be my last thought because she's ready to steal the mic from me. And this is gonna be the last thing I wanna say. Let us remember this. If we ever get down and feel like I can't do something, one person, I can't do something, take a look at Mary Hines Johnson, and you'll realize you can. Thank you all for allowing me to speak. Love and God bless.
Thank you, Greg. was founded on October the 11th in 1890, and today we have over 190,000 members around the world. Our objectives are historic preservation, education, and patriotism. The Women in American History Award is a national award that is sponsored at chapter level. Each year, our chapter chooses a woman to honor for this recognition by taking into consideration women who have made a contribution or a difference in their community. She must be worthy of recognition, and we are directed to look for women who are or have been intellectual, educational, social, religious, or cultural innovators. There is no doubt that Mary Hines Johnson was a notable woman in this community and met every one of these criteria. Accepting the award today on behalf of the Mary Hines Johnson Foundation and her family, please welcome Ms. Frankie Berry Wise.
Inadequate building with practically no books. I was young, too young for the thoughts I was thinking. I looked into that sea of eager faces and then at the bleak walls and the poor lighting and searched inside me for some kind of answer. I summoned all the ambition and power within me and their vow I would one day make a wonderful history for my race in the field of education. I can almost see myself now as I stood before the group, even at the age of age 14. I realized that in order to be a successful teacher, one must love one's work and strive daily to make each student feel that he or she belongs and is wanted. Also, I learned that ideals and hard work are the keys to success. I was sent to a one-teacher school 8 miles from home in an isolated community, the nearest structure being 1.5 miles from the school. When the rains came, which they did often in winter, many had to stay home for days at a time. Those who did get to school between showers were forced to huddle in a corner of a leaking building. Did these handicaps tend to drive my mind into another channel of thought other than teaching? No. They only threw out a challenge to my young heart, causing me to work harder towards some kind of plan for the carry out of a program aimed at giving my color a better chance for future success and happiness. In the year 1909, I began teaching at Ebenezer Church, 1.5 miles up the Noon Highway from Franklin, Georgia. Some of our boys and girls left the school to bless the world with great service. Many of them went from there to high school and finished. One boy finished his 7th grade there, went through high school, and then earned money to finish at Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia, where he now teaches. Another is a distinguished minister in a North Georgia church. In 1914, I married, teaching that year also. In 1916, my first child was born. I taught every year I was able until I decided to start teaching and build my family. This I did, resuming my teaching in the year of 1936 at the same Ebenezer Church where I taught 10 years in succession. I found some changes in the location of the students' homes. Many had moved. All the children except 10 lived in Franklin. These 10 lived 3 miles below Franklin. These 3 miles and the 1.5 miles from Franklin to the church made 4.5 miles for the children to help you walk. To me, it was a deplorable situation. And my mind kept telling me something had to be done. I eased the situation off a bit by picking up the smaller children and letting the older ones walk. During the winter months, I have often shared my gloves and my extra coat with some of the children. My brains were busy all this time to think of some way whereby these children would not have to walk all this long distance to school. I looked at the white children ride past and thought, would it come to me if anybody wants something and is willing to work hard for it, he will get it. Well, do I remember that day when some child said, while I was in the midst of a geography class, Mrs. Johnson, it is going to rain. Looking out, I saw a cloud that was threatening. Perhaps we had better go, I said, trying to not to show my concern too much, for I could tell there was perhaps a storm on the way. Before we reached the first bridge, the rain came down in sheets. The lightning flashed and the thunder rolled. The children began screaming and running around me. We would get under the next bridge and then it won't rain on us. I told them, trying to keep down their fears. We reached the bridge and there we sat, 25 students and I. There came something to me that day. I would make an effort to get a school here in Franklin for the colored children. I said in my heart as we crawled from under the bridge and went on to meet the ancient parents of most of the children. Here we are, a group of parents. The stage was set for me to voice my resolution. It was now or never. Do you want a school building near your home in order to avoid just what we have endured? I asked, and was surprised at the new ring in my voice. Yes, but we haven't any money, came one voice. How can such a thing be done with no state on where to start? Was the question I asked, do you want a school? Yes, yes, they all cried. The next morning found me in our superintendent's office telling him of my plans, which he seemed to think was what we needed to do. We were not able to employ a contractor. We were fortunate to get Mr. Emmy Jackson to put up the little brown schoolhouse at a cost of $495. On completion, we began teaching in it on Wednesday, November 23rd, 1942. Yet we have raised all the $495. We needed more money, plus a heater. The note for the balance due was at hand. I told the superintendent I would assign my paycheck for the school year in order to pay off the balance. I'll never forget the day, Wednesday, November 23rd, 1942, when the children arrived bright and early at the little brown building. They were all smiles. One little girl squeezed my hand and asked, we won't have to walk so far now, will we? When I said to her, we will only have to walk the distance from town to which was only a good height to cover each morning, she said, I'm going to try and never be tardy. This inspired me more than words could tell. So I set out to work to do more planning, and in the year 1947, 9 more schools were consolidated through the help of our county superintendent. Our school grew from a 1 teacher to a 7 teacher school, and the students were transported to school on buses. This brought many children back to school who had been out for 4 years or more. To me, this was a challenge. If these students could see and appreciate the move by coming back to school, to me, they deserved the best. Each classroom was overcrowded. We had neither auditorium, library, lunchroom, nor anything that could inspire these young people to complete their high school education. During the year 1950, the Board of Education, our superintendent, changed the name of our school from Ebenezer School to Mary Johnson High School. It seemed to me I was in a trance. When my mind began to function, my first thought was, the job isn't complete. There's more work to do. I look forward to the day when there would come a time when there would be a modern school building here in Franklin, Georgia, for Negro boys and girls. 10 years is a long time to pray for. But through prayer, cooperation, and teamwork, we now have a modern school that has grown from a 1 teacher school to a 22 teacher school. I am grateful. Mary Hines Johnson.
Thank you, Ms. Wise. In our concluding remarks this morning, I want to share with you that the foundation has graciously donated the writings of Mary Hines Johnson entitled A Dream Come True, The Story of My Life as a Teacher to the Hurt Historical Society. A copy is also going to be donated to the archives at Berry College in Rome. Her legacy and life will be remembered after today and passed on to many generations to come. Today's award will become a permanent part of our history in the DAR also. Her information will be recorded and documented as part of our proceedings. These documents are compiled and sent to our national office, and they'll be stored at the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C. Jay Barker, our chaplain, will come and give our closing prayer this morning.
May we pray? Dear Lord, thank you for this special ceremony and all the work that was accomplished. May we work for your kingdom with the same diligence and sacrifice. We ask your Holy Spirit to inspire us as we leave this place, and may it dwell in us so that others see grace and truth in us every day. As we go, surround us with your love and protect us with your hand. In your precious and holy name we ask.
Thank you, Jane, and thank you all for coming this morning. This concludes our program.
That died.